Hi everyone, we're engineers on the AIM organization on Netflix, and we're going to introduce you to our systems and architecture. My name is Marilés Caille, and I work in the device identity systems team.
I'm Travis Nelson. I work on the PEAS team. We work on security protocols and authentication and authorization.
Hi, my name is Abhishek Pandey. I work for user systems and data team. We store your identity and state information. Thank you.
So what is AIM? AIM is the set of systems within Netflix that handle access and identity management. We manage a lot of backend services related to customers' accounts and profiles, as well as authentication and authorization, as well as handling security protocols and encapsulating this information in a token agnostic way for downstream services to use. Additionally, we handle backend services for authentication and authorization of devices, which give us a lot of ways to personalize device context and handle the relationship between users and devices and the previous configuration needed to handle these devices within the Netflix ecosystem. So in what context do we do this work? Partnerships are a big part of the work that we do here at Netflix, and the AIM organization works in close collaboration with many other teams and organizations at Netflix, like the growth team, the customer service teams, UI, data analytics, and device partners. So I'm gonna pass it now to my colleague, Travis.
Thanks, Mari. So I'm gonna go into a little bit more detail about what we do at AIM. We provide a lot of the user and device data to various other systems and services within the Netflix ecosystem. We authenticate and authorize access to both users and devices. We deal with different security protocols. We have kind of a custom security protocol that we use here at Netflix, in addition to using various kinds of tokens over TLS. And we also need to deal with product flexibility. It's one thing to have a system that is very secure and scalable, and another to have one that is secure, scalable, and flexible. So we're really trying to build for kind of all of those different dimensions. We look at what we do. It's also, we have a tremendous scaling that we do it here at Netflix. We have over 1 billion user profiles. We have about 3 million requests coming in per second that we need to authenticate. I'm going to be going into a little bit more about how we actually do that. We have 30 different microsystems just within the AIM organization. There's obviously many, many more in all of Netflix, but within just AIM, there's 30. And then we have about 30 million reads per second at peak, and about 300,000 writes. That's for some of our databases, and we have about 100 terabytes in one of our biggest DBs. So we're really dealing at a very large scale. So what I want to do is kind of walk you through where AIM operates within the context of a request coming into to the Netflix service. So on the upper left corner, you'll see a Z that represents Zool, which is an open source system that we've developed here at Netflix. And it provides kind of layer 7 routing capabilities. And we've actually done some extensions to it to enable it to do some authentication for us. And so when a request comes in, it comes into Zool, and then we first have to kind of decide which protocol is being used, do that authentication. And if that authentication requires some additional processing, we send it over to one of our off-box services, which are represented here as edge auth services. So things like a cookie renewal or device authentication, that kind of thing, will have to go into one of those services. And then we send the request down to what's represented here as the application layer. And that's really the kind of the whole set of microservices that are available within Netflix. And those services that will reach out to various AIM services at various points, depending on what's necessary at a given point in time. So if we needed to do authentication or authorization, go into those services, right? The auth in and auth z bucket that we have represented there. We also have the ability to give device information, which is kind of the device box there. We also have the ability to give user profile related information. So that is on the right, on the lower quadrant there that you'll see. So what I'm going to do next is kind of drill down a little bit further into both the edge auth services and the authentication and authorization services. So what you'll see here is kind of an expanded view of those edge authentication services. So we have the traffic that's coming into Zool, and then we have the first kind of thing we decide when some traffic comes in is what protocol am I using, right? We have kind of two primary protocols that are used here. We have one that's MISL, which is kind of a proprietary Netflix protocol. And then another one, which is basically bearer tokens over TLS. So that can be cookies. So we represented here in this chart as cookies. So what we try to do is authenticate the request as much as we can within the scope of the Zool system. And if we determine that we need additional processing, then there's that things that will take a little bit more time, say a device authentication or a cookie renewal, something like that, we send it off box. So what you'll see is that the MISL requests are going up and to the right to a service that we have called StayPuffed, which processes MISL. And then if it's a cookie request and needs additional processing, it goes down to the left there to a service that we have called Slimer, which is our cookie manager service. So what we have here is kind of a haunting of ghosts that kind of helps Zool along with the edge authentication. And what we're trying to do in the end is end up with a passport, which is the token agnostic identity. It's no matter what security protocol is being used, we always create a passport and send it down to the application layer. The application layer can then inspect that passport to determine who is the user, what's the device type, what claims were used to authenticate this user. And we can use that for things like authorization purposes or to just collect the right user information to have it go to the right place. Next, I want to talk a little bit more about authorization. So historically at Netflix, we've done a kind of a distributed authorization model. And what that means is that every service was doing kind of its own authorization within its own code. So you can imagine that if a service requires a user to be a paying user, it would have a check that would say that this user must be a currently paying member in order to do this particular function. And you might have, say, 40 of those services all doing that same check. And if you build things in that way, you end up with a service that is very, it can be scalable and it can be fault tolerant, but it can't really be flexible because every time you need to change that logic, you need to go in and change it in all those different services that are implementing that same authorization function. So what we're trying to do here is to centralize that authorization into a service that we're calling PAX. And PAX has the ability to basically answer authorization questions on behalf of a user and their context. So the user, you'll see that on the right, you have the user state coming into PAX. That is the user, their current status, the device they're coming in on, the geo they're coming in on, all of that stuff. And a lot of that is represented inside of that passport. It comes into PAX, and then from there we can make policy-based decisions. So at the bottom, you'll see the policies, which are kind of the rules that are there to represent that those authorizations. We have a few different APIs that we have for PAX, so various callers that can call in. One of them is what we call a feature API. So that can determine whether the user can do coarse grain things like browse or download, that sort of thing. We also have the ability to change the slate of content available for a user. So we have that capability as well. So we can give that information to our discovery services. And at the bottom there, you'll see the playback service can call in and ask, can this user play this particular video? And so that kind of allows us to have that broad suite of authorization and all inside of this PAX service. Now you can imagine that if we're doing things at the scale we do, which is about 4 million RPS or so, we really want to be able to do that very quickly. We need to have very low latency. We need to basically reduce our server-side costs because we have a lot of requests coming in. And if we did everything in terms of the everything going to the server and running those policies, it would be very expensive. We need a very large suite of services and it would be potentially kind of slow to do that. So we need to speed it up. And we do that in two different ways. One is with a request scope cache, which allows the PAX client to determine if that particular authorization request has already happened. And if it has, it just returns the same answer that it got before. The other way is through a distributed cache here as memcached. And what that does is allows the PAX server can write the authorization answer into memcached. And then when the PAX client sees that it needs to process a particular request, it goes to the memcached first. And if it doesn't find it there, it will go back to the PAX service. And so that basically allows that two level of caching helps us reduce the amount of traffic on the server significantly. You see here that we have from 4 million RPS down to about 200,000 RPS is actually going to the server. And then the server is what actually writes it back to memcached. Now, the other problem we have to deal with is, since this is an authorization service, if the authorization information becomes stale, that can be problematic because the state of the user or the device or various things can change. And so what we do is we have kind of two different mechanisms for handling that. One is by having the user systems go in and write a dirty flag into our cache, which allows us to kind of see that. And then we know that cache entry is no longer valid. We also have an asynchronous program here called CacheBuster, which allows us to do kind of asynchronous deletes on that cache. And so that's kind of how we achieve that level of scale and performance that we need to operate at this level. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Mari to talk about devices.
Thank you, Travis. I'm going to talk about how the device ecosystem takes place within this realm of access and identity management. As you know, Netflix is available in almost 200 countries with hundreds of device partners, thousands of device types, and hundreds of millions of devices. Supporting this ecosystem makes us think about the need for a strong device identification and management that provides that seamless Netflix experience that you have come to know. So I'm going to explain how we architect these systems to fulfill this need. There are three areas where device identity takes place and is involved. And the very first one is the priori knowledge that we want to have about new device types that we onboard in partnership with device partners like Samsung, LG, and Apple. The second area is device identity and trust that involves boot up, runtime, and device trust, all the services related to providing this information for us. And finally, data services related to device identity. All these services ensure that we keep the device identity state, and these include very large data sets that is used for both online and analytic use cases. So I'm going to explain how these services come together for providing device access and identity by illustrating where each of these services come together when a request starts at Azure. The very first service that a device calls when it tries to launch the Netflix application is the Netflix Books service. This is one of the critical services that Netflix app calls on a startup and is used to establish the cryptographic root of trust of the device. This service also has additional responsibility of responding with the Netflix URL to download the assets, the images and assets that the app will need for boot up, and also for delivering the client logs that is processed by one of our playback data systems. The Netflix boot service is called every time the app starts or reloads. This service does not store any data and uses different sources to serve trust store files to clients. After the device gets the necessary information to boot the Netflix app, it starts a request at Azure, and the process of authentication and authorization that Travis just explained takes place. But then Azure passes this information to the application layer services. Let's see how this works in more detail. So the device property type service is composed of two main components. The admin that manages the creation of device type properties and the rollouts that can be rolled out to one or million of devices. This is the part where our device partners team create these device types when we onboard new device types or create properties for these device types. And this enables testing, debugging, and experimentation by our partners teams. The second component of the device type property service which is the relevant for in the context of a request from Zool, is the runtime component. And the runtime provides lookup of device types and their properties, and is available by Zool, which uses the device type property service to hydrate the request with device type information, which is used by application layer services later to use it on their own services. Then these application layer services can use it to look up specific properties that they might be interested in. As you can imagine, this service gets hit a lot of requests, around 5 million requests per second on the client. Thankfully, device type properties are a big candidate for caching because they don't change a lot. This allows us to implement three basic means of caching that allow us to have this huge savings between 5 million requests per second on the client and 30K requests per second on the server. We use three main ways for caching. One was a solution, internal Netflix solution similar to Memcached. Then we also use a data store enabled cache. That this is also an internal Netflix solution, but it's at the data store level. And finally, we also use a cache on the gRPC client and the server side, allowing us to have this very huge performance save that has been very relevant for how our system reacted. The other service that I want to show you today is the device action service. This is a service that application layers can use to perform device actions like reset the Netflix app for devices that have gotten into a bad state and might need resetting. This is particularly useful for partners' device teams where they are debugging of customer support. Device actions also allow us to implement features like mobile-only plan. What device action does is annotate the request at Zool level when a device action is passed to for a specific user and a device. It also manages the lifecycle of these actions and provide insights on them. The device action service uses an architecture that relies on Bloom filters that provides memory optimization at the Zool level where performance is very critical. The Bloom filter has a no false negative guarantee, so we can be sure that the filter responds that the element when the filter responds that the element is not in it, saving a trip to any of the external systems or data stores that we have, considerably lowering the number of requests that we need to do to the service. The final service that I want to talk about today related to the device identity and system is the device insight system. And this service aggregates device identity and state information from the Netflix boot service logs, the device action service, and the device property service to track the evolution of devices across the Netflix ecosystem. This is one of the databases and data sets that provides analytic use cases for device insight at the Netflix ecosystem. Device identity services have a couple of things going on for them that make it a very cool space for us. One, there is not a single architecture for all of our systems. And second, we have a lot of data to deal with in both a state and a stateless ways. We have services with low RPS and a lot of RPS. So device identity services are a part of the Netflix experience from Bootstrap until insights and analytics. And I'm gonna pass it down to my colleague Abby now to talk about user systems and data.
Thank you, Marie. So I'll talk about the user systems here at Netflix, which is part of AIM as well. And with that, I want to start talking about the two main facets of USD. There's one, the product side, where we enable the product side of things within Netflix. And the other is the infra and the platform side, where we enable developers and other microservices within Netflix to take key decisions on user data. We enable Netflix product by creating user identity. So think of like account and profile IDs, their GUIDs, emails, phone numbers, their indexes associated with them. We persist user data like profile name, maturity settings, parental control, et cetera. We also enable state changes from new member to becoming paid member or to become former member, something like that. This enables Netflix systems to answer questions like if an account has an ability to watch something. Apart from critical data around users like identity and state, we also own systems that allows users to have multiple preferences. Something like subtitle settings that you see on your device, a TV, when you are watching your favorite show. And this is like across devices, across multiple profiles. On the infra side of the things, we enable developers and services to consume the user state changes via events. We routinely scan our databases and work closely with privacy and security teams to keep your data protected and removed once you become a former member. We are also foraying into the service orchestration platform, which will allow us to create a state among multiple services in distributed fashion. On the next slide, here I want to talk about some of the services that we own and how we do certain things that I talked about in the earlier slide. So in the middle, you see a user identity and state management, which is a combination of multiple services that we own within user systems. Think of like the services that allow you to create profile or delete profile or create your state or create an account. So we call them as a subscriber service and a profile service. Now, when the request comes to Netflix ecosystem through a device or TV, it goes all the way from Zool to Auth, the device services that Marie and Travis have talked about, but end up in user identity and state management services. The user identity and state management services have less to no dependencies at all. So when you create a new account, when a new customer gets on board to a Netflix ecosystem, the request all the way comes to our systems, and then we create a unique ID associated with that account. The unique ID and identity generator here is a distributed service that runs across multiple regions and data centers, but gives you a unique identity, which is your unique identity among all the users in Netflix. And this is a main key that every service in Netflix uses to take which user it is. We have, we also use, Cassandra as our database, which is one of the largest database in Netflix that we store, all the user state and identity and profiles and all of that. We have heavily invested into how to make our data model to fit into memory. We use, cache heavily. We have three different types of cache, one on the client side, and the other one is request scope cache, and the third one is the distributed memcached. The total RPS on our services ranges from 30 to 35 million reads per second, and the writes are around the range of 300 to 400K per second. We also allow the DVD side of the business by creating a DVD proxy layer, which is kind of like a layer which translates DVD side of business to internals within Netflix ecosystem. Now, I also wanted to talk about certain challenges that we face on the user identity and state management side. The main key challenge here is, how to make sure that, you create a certain state within Netflix ecosystem and also allows other services to consume that state. So here, I want to talk about certain aspects of user systems and data team where we allow you to create state, and then internal developers and users could use that state as form of internal UIs. And also we allow certain kind of internal and external testing by using some of the logics that we have and services that we have to do tester management. We also create event stream that basically when you change your password or when you change your email or phone number, all these change events goes to the Kafka streams, which then consumed by other services within Netflix ecosystem to answer questions like, if you get an email when you change your password or things like that. The other services read our update logs to take critical decisions on what to do with that state change. We also reduce our data footprint on our Cassandra database by running offline schedulers that scan our database routinely and pick accounts that have been old enough to remove them from our database and squeeze our database. We have we work very closely with customer support and security team to revert a state on an account if the account got compromised. Now think of let's say the account gets hacked and somebody changed the password on that. They reach out to customer support team and customer support team gets that unique identifier and that account information and reverts the state on that account. Now on the next slides, I want to talk about how different pieces within AIM work together to realize a use case that you might have encountered very commonly working on Netflix ecosystem. So what happens when you hit play on your device, right? The user hits play in order to start a playback. This results in a request to the Netflix backend to generate a manifest. The request is authenticated at the Zool layer. Since this will be a MISL request, we may call out to MISL service for additional processing if needed. We generate a passport at the Zool layer. Then this request goes to playback and licensing team for DRM verification. Playback will also call out to DCMS in order to customize the response based on the device type and trust and capabilities. Playback will also call PAX to determine if the user or device should have access to this video or content. PAX will call into user systems in order to determine the plan, what plan might you have, the status, if the account is a current member or not, and other user attributes. If PAX return true, meaning the user has access to this video, Playback will return a manifest and license to the player, which can then begin streaming the content, and voila, your favorite content is able to be watched. So if you're interested to learn more, you can always check the links on our website. Thank you so much.